Hey. Well, hello, everybody. Thanks for joining us today. Today is April 19, 2021, and we are gathered together to talk about our questions and answers around the coronavirus vaccine. And we have different experts with us from Pillars Community Health. And we want to make sure that we record this for today so we could share it with our partners and our communities and other folks who may need this information, because it's such important information. So I can start by saying my name is Anna Padron-Sikora, and I am a licensed clinical social worker, and I work at Pillars Community Health. My role is community engagement, but I've been working in the agency for over 20 years under mental health and behavioral health. So I'm very glad to be here today, and want to have this opportunity to talk, to have Lorena and Abby introduce themselves, and then we will have a presentation by Lorena, and then a question and answers by Abby, and we'll learn more about the vaccine and some of the facts that we need to know in our community. So Lorena, if you want to go ahead and introduce yourself.
Hi, my name is Lorena. I'm also with Pillars Community Health. My role is the COVID Outreach and Education Specialist. So my main focus is to make sure that the community has all the information, accurate information regarding the COVID-19 vaccines and just prevention, and making sure that I disseminate that information.
Hi, everyone. My name is Abby. I'm a registered nurse here at Pillars Community Health. I have been a nurse for about 5 years now. I have experience with ICU nursing, infection control, a little bit of employee health, and now public health. I help run a COVID vaccine clinic here at Pillars. We vaccinate every day. And we answer a lot of questions throughout. So I'll be the question and answer person for today.
Yes, and thank you so much. And we know that this information is, you know, specific to today, because things seem to change every day. But we want to get as much information out, especially because we are finally at a point where we're having more access to vaccine appointments, and we want people to have the information that they need in order to make those decisions to sign up for a vaccine. So I think with that, we'll lead right into Lorena's presentation.
Okay, so we'll go ahead and get started. I'm just gonna pull this up a little bit bigger. And so this is a COVID-19 vaccine information presentation. I'm going to go over general basic information regarding the vaccine, and then we'll move on to answer some of the questions with Abby. We'll cover safety, how vaccines work, types of COVID-19 vaccines, the benefits of getting vaccinated, cost and distribution, and Q&A. So first off, I just wanted to share this statement made by the CDC. It's in regards to safety. The vaccines met FDA's rigorous scientific standards for safety, effectiveness, and manufacturing quality needed to support emergency use authorization. Basically, what they're saying is that COVID-19 vaccines are safe and effective. There were no steps skipped during the clinical trial process for COVID-19 vaccines. Although the vaccine development is faster than normal, it is still safe, and it's only because this is a global effort and steps were being done at the same time instead of one after another. So how do vaccines work? When we think about how vaccines work, we have to think about how our immune system works. Whenever we get sick, our bodies use red and white blood cells to fight infection. The immune system learns how to protect the body against illness by using memory cells to remember how to fight the virus in the future. And so the vaccines, specifically the COVID vaccines, help our bodies develop immunity to the virus without having to get sick with COVID-19. We have two types of vaccines out on the market right now, the mRNA vaccines, and then one vector vaccine, which is on pause, and we'll go further into detail in a minute. mRNA vaccines give instructions for our cells to make a harmless piece of what is called the spike protein. Once the instructions, the mRNA, are inside the immune cells, so the cells use them to make the protein piece. When our immune system recognizes that there's a protein that doesn't belong there, it begins to build an immune response and making antibodies. So that when you get exposed to COVID-19 virus, you already have these antibodies to help you fight it off. We have the Pfizer, which is our first mRNA vaccine. It is two shots at least 21 days apart. It does not contain eggs, preservatives, or latex, and it is 95% effective at preventing COVID-19. The other mRNA vaccine is the Moderna vaccine. It is two shots at least 28 days apart, does not contain eggs, preservatives, latex, and it is 94.5% effective at preventing COVID-19. And then we have the one vector vaccine, which is a vector, is a virus that causes COVID-19, but it's not the actual COVID-19 virus. So it enters a cell in our body to produce a harmless piece of the virus that causes COVID-19. Our immune system recognizes it, it doesn't belong there, and it triggers our immune system to produce antibodies and activate all the immune cells to fight off what it thinks is an infection. And again, we have this immune response and antibodies that will fight off the COVID-19 virus if we are exposed, but we never had to get sick with the COVID-19 virus. And that is a Johnson & Johnson vaccine, which is only one shot. It does not contain eggs, preservatives, or latex. And this one is 66% effective at preventing COVID-19. There has been an update on the Johnson & Johnson vaccine. On April 13, 2021, which was last week, the CDC and FDA recommended a pause in the use of the Johnson & Johnson Janssen COVID-19 vaccine. Of the nearly 7 million doses administered so far in the United States, a small number of reports of a rare and severe type of blood clot have been reported in people after receiving the J&J vaccine. We just wanted to add this because it's on pause, the vaccine is still being studied, and these sick cases were only 6. So there was only 6 out of almost 7 million cases, million doses that had these rare blood clots. And so they're testing whether it's the same in the regular population. So how many people get these blood clots in the regular population that did not receive the vaccine, and how many people are getting it with the Johnson & Johnson vaccine. And so we'll update as we get more information from the studies. And then these are the comparisons again. So we have the brands on top. The Pfizer, Moderna, Johnson & Johnson, they're three different names because they're three different brands of vaccines. But like I said before, Pfizer and Moderna are mRNA, so they work in a similar way. And then the viral vector is a different type of vaccine. They all require different doses. Well, Moderna and Pfizer require 2, and then Johnson & Johnson 1. And their peak effectiveness, meaning when are you immune to the COVID-19 virus after receiving the vaccine. For Pfizer, it will be 7 days after the second dose. Moderna will be 14 days, so about 2 weeks after the second dose. And then Johnson & Johnson would be 28 days after the first and single dose. So how effective is each vaccine? Which one's better? All of them are effective 100% against death. They're all really good vaccines. All three are highly effective at preventing COVID-19 related severe infections and deaths. They vary in severe infection, but they're all above 75% effective at preventing severe infection. So what do I have to expect after getting vaccinated? Some people don't have any side effects at all. Others report pain or swelling at the injection site, a headache, chills, muscle aches, or fever. You may have one or all of the side effects. They are all completely normal and they will subside within 3 days. The benefits of getting vaccinated, it helps you from getting COVID-19 without you having to get sick with COVID-19. Helps keep you from getting seriously ill, even if you do get COVID-19. As we saw, there is still a chance of getting COVID-19, but you reduce the risk of being hospitalized and death. Protect people around you. It's a safer way to build protection. Your immune system will fight the virus if you are exposed, and eventually it'll help stop the pandemic. So how much is a vaccine? The vaccine is free. You do not need to be insured to receive a vaccine. If you do have insurance, we ask that you take your insurance information to your vaccine appointment. This will be used for reimbursement for the administration fees, but you will not be charged a copay or anything for the vaccine. And all residents of Cook County, DuPage County, and all the counties of Illinois are eligible to be vaccinated, included undocumented residents. The distribution, this is just a little graph that we can see where we had limited doses, and so that's why we had the phases at first. And now as we encounter a large number of doses available, we're starting to see the phases open up in some counties, and I believe it's available to everyone over the age of 16, as long as those in the 16 to 17 age range are taking the Pfizer vaccine. And these are the phases that we've seen in the past. Right now, everyone is eligible. Again, all individuals age 16 and older. Where can I get the vaccine? We will be having that pop-up on Saturday where Pillars Community Health will be administering the vaccine. If you know anyone who lives in Cook County, they can sign up for the community vaccination program at vaccine.cookcounty.gov. You can also call the number on the screen. They have a hotline that is available Monday through Friday from 7 a.m. to 10 p.m. and Saturday, 8 a.m. to 10 p.m. We also have the option for those who are homebound and need to receive a vaccine in-house. And there's also a number for that as well. In DuPage County, they have a similar sign-up registration link at dupagehealth.org. Or you can call for assistance at 630-682-7400. Other vaccination options include federally qualified health centers, so that would be Pillars Community Health. Pharmacies like Walgreens, Jewel Osco, Mariano, CVS are also offering the vaccines, and to sign up for those, you'd have to go through their websites. There are also community pop-ups, which is similar to what we're doing in Burridge or in DuPage. And then we're also having another pop-up in Summit that we're seeing. And so this is from the Cook County Department of Public Health, but we'll be seeing more in other communities. And if you live in Chicago or know someone who lives in Chicago and does not work in any of the suburbs, then they can go to chicago.gov. They have a vaccination finder. And so here is an example of a pop-up. This is going on in Summit for those who live or work in Summit, McCook, Hodgkins, Justice, Bridgeview, or Chicago Ridge. They have a hotline there as well, just for those people who are scheduling appointments at this location. And remember to wear a mask. Continue to watch your distance, stay at least 6 feet away from others. Wash your hands frequently for at least 20 seconds. Get tested if you develop any COVID-19 symptoms and answer the call from contact tracers. And of course, get vaccinated when you're able to. And that was the presentation. We can move on to some of the questions and answers.
Wonderful. That was lovely, Lorena. Thank you. So the questions that we have, we really have been collecting them through our listening sessions in community. So we have been able to go to several different communities and really find out what are some of the anxieties or the concerns that people have around the vaccine, and so that some of the answers are in the presentation that Lorena just shared, and so we'll be using that as a reference. But as Abby said, she is in the vaccine clinic at Pillars Community Health all day long and answering questions all day long, and so I'm gonna ask you a couple of the questions that came in from community, and then Abby, like really, if you could share with us, what is the process look like when somebody comes in to get a vaccine? What do they fill out? Like, what can people expect if they haven't received the vaccine? Just so people can feel better about that and about the information that they need to come and get the vaccine.
Okay, so there are different ways to schedule an appointment. It can be via phone call, a website. You can do an online appointment through email. So once you have your appointment, usually they ask you to bring in some form of identification and then your insurance if you have it. If not, that's fine. So you'll come into the clinic. You'll have your temperature taken. You'll have this clipboard with a questionnaire, basically just going a little more in depth with your medical history, if you've recently been vaccinated, if you're having any like flu-like symptoms, if you have any type of like allergies, the severity of your allergies, or if you're currently on any type of medication. After that, you are then guided to one of our various stations with a registered nurse there present or a provider there, and they'll just go through that paperwork with you, answering any immediate questions. They'll explain the type of vaccine you're going to be receiving, the effectiveness of it. If it's Pfizer, Moderna, they both have a 95% effectiveness, but because it is a two-dose series, you do need both of those vaccines to have that true effectiveness. And then they'll explain how often you have to come back. Pfizer, like Lorena mentioned, it's 3 weeks, Moderna it's 4 weeks. And then they'll just briefly explain that the vaccine is based off of a protein that teaches your body how to protect yourself, how to recognize that virus. You had no part, have the live coronavirus injected into you, so you will not be contagious. And then they'll go through some of the side effects that you might experience. So both are similar to a cold or a flu, so more like of the headache, the body aches, the fever, the chills, the fatigue, maybe some nausea. All of that is going to be mild, maybe 2 to 3 days, and it's not necessarily a person can experience every single symptom. It's just one, none, which is also normal. But we explain that having these symptoms is totally normal. It's the body's way of adapting to the vaccine. We then explain that things that you can take to counteract that is just resting. Don't overexert your body. You can take Tylenol or ibuprofen, whichever one is normally the one that you take. And then we give you these two packets. One is more information on the vaccine that you can read. And then there's an application called VSafe, which is partnered with CDC, that explains how to download it on your phone. It follows up with you, it answers questions on side effects, it follows up with your next appointment, and it creates like an electronic vaccine record. And then as a precaution, we have you wait 15 minutes after you've been vaccinated just to monitor for any immediate adverse effects. So it's a very easy process. You walk in, you fill out paperwork, we explain the vaccine, you're vaccinated, you wait, and then you're good to go. And then it is available in English and Spanish. So if there's any type of translation needed, those can be accommodated for you.
Addie, what vaccine do we give at Pillars Community Health right now?
Right now we have the Moderna vaccine.
Okay. And Abby, are some folks, when they come into the vaccine clinic, are they nervous or do they have like some hesitation as they come into the clinic?
Yes, because it is a new vaccine, it's totally normal to be a little nervous at first. I always ask, hey, how are you feeling? Are you happy, excited, nervous? Are you just like, I've been waiting a long time for it? So addressing those immediate feelings, immediate concerns are great. And then we ask why. Why are you nervous? That way we have a chance to answer questions before we start. So it makes the person more comfortable receiving that vaccine.
Because I think, you know, since the vaccine came out in December, there's been a lot of information, a lot of noise about the vaccine, right? And so if we listen to the news all day long, it gets confusing, right? And like what to believe and what's right. And so I think sometimes just having somebody there to answer questions is really helpful.
Right. A lot of the confusion or the anxiety comes from miscommunication, like you mentioned. So news outlets, friends of friends, or just other people's experiences. We have to take into account every person is different. Everybody is different. Everyone has different medical conditions. So making sure someone is very well educated before making a decision is very important.
Abby, what about if people say, like, which vaccine is better? I mean, I know we just heard from Lorena about the different types. Which one would you say is better?
So whichever one is in front of you is the best one to take. Like it says in the first row, all of them are 100% effective against death. All three of them are great keeping you out of the hospital with those very severe symptoms. It takes you away from being in the ICU, being intubated or dying. So all of them are great. Whichever one you're able to schedule an appointment for is the best one.
Awesome. And, you know, you talked about some of the side effects and Lorena, you know, kind of talked a little bit of what to expect. Excuse me. And one of the questions that came from the community was that if the side effects can be contagious, like if I'm not feeling well, can I pass it on to my family?
So no, actually, like I mentioned before, having these symptoms are normal. Not necessarily are you going to have all of those symptoms, but it's your own body doing its job working. It's adapting to the vaccine. At no part there's any actual COVID vaccine. COVID virus being injected into you. It's a protein that teaches your body how to recognize it to protect you. So just because you're feeling a little under the weather does not mean you're contagious, because you don't have COVID. It's your own body that's doing its job adapting. So like I said, maybe a day and a half, you're not feeling that great, and then you're back to normal. So you're not contagious. You won't get anyone else around you sick. It's your own body working.
Abby, can you tell us a little bit of like why you need two doses and like why it's so important to come back for the second one?
Yes. So it depends on those two doses. So Pfizer and Moderna were manufactured. The company who made them recommend to have that full effectiveness, you do need those two doses as opposed of the Johnson & Johnson, you just need one. And like it's mentioned in this chart, peak effectiveness, after your first dose of the vaccine, your body starts, it takes a few weeks to start creating immunity towards the virus. Not immediately are you gonna have that full immunity. It takes your body some time to start building up, recognizing, creating those antibodies to protect you. It's that second vaccine that you put in that increase your antibody levels that protect you for a longer time. So it's kind of like a booster that protects you for longer. That's why you need both of them to get that full 95% effectiveness to it.
So would you say, Abby, that one is better than none, but two is the full effectiveness?
Right. So getting one, starting off with one, is starting to give you some protection. It's just important to come back to have that full protection afterwards.
Abby, one of the other questions that have come up often is that if I've had COVID-19 in the last year, do I still need the vaccine?
So yes, I know that everyone has been a little nervous, especially if they've had a severe case of COVID in the past. But what we've learned is that the natural immunity that we create after having the virus, those antibodies, we don't know how long they'll last for. It used to say 90 days, so about 3 months. What we do know is that putting this vaccine in, it will last longer than if you were naturally immune. So besides the natural immunity we get, with this vaccine, it's like an added protection layer to protect us. So yes, it's recommended that you have both, even if you've had it.
Abby, what about, what do we know about how long this vaccine or these vaccines will protect us? Like, do you hear, sometimes people have asked if we're gonna need another booster, like in a year or in 6 months? What have you heard about that?
So we are, because the vaccine is still new, there are still ongoing studies. Most likely we'll hear probably by the end of the year, maybe fall, end of the year, the frequency of the vaccine. We don't know if this will be like an every year, like the flu shot, an annual shot, or if it'll be like our other vaccines, which are every 3 to 5 years, where we'll need a booster in the future. So as time goes on and those case studies are ongoing, they'll probably let us know. And that way we let you guys know as well. We'll both find out at the same time.
And you mentioned the allergies. And so I had heard that if folks have some food allergies or some other kind of more severe allergies, that do you have them stay to be observed longer, a little bit longer?
So yes, as a precaution, we have everyone wait those normal 15 minutes. But if someone has a history of a more severe allergic reaction where it deems them to go to the hospital, like an anaphylaxis reaction where they're having trouble breathing, there's inflammation in their lips, their eyes, some of that sort, where they need like an EpiPen, we have them wait an extra 30 minutes after their vaccination just as a precaution.
And what about if people often ask, like, if they have diabetes or high blood pressure or some other existing medical conditions, is it safe for them to get the vaccine as well?
Yes, we're actually recommending having a comorbidity or a chronic condition like diabetes, high blood pressure, anything else like an autoimmune disease, something like that. We actually recommend it even more because it puts you at an even more vulnerable risk to getting COVID and having those negative symptoms. So yes, definitely recommending it. It's an added protector, you know, with their medication.
And sometimes I think that it's also great for them to have those conversations with their doctors, right? If they are receiving specific treatment, or if they have maybe a medical condition that's more complicated, right?
We always have, if someone is having like some hesitancy, or if there's anything else going on with their medical history, we always have them refer back to their doctors. Their doctors know more of their history than we do. So making sure that their doctor is okay with it, or if they have any questions on their medication with the vaccine, it's always refer back to your doctor and then come back and let us know.
But that while they are at any of the vaccine clinics, that medical professionals that are administering the vaccines, they're all certified. They're all medical professionals, correct?
Yeah. We're all licensed. We're all trained with our basic life saving aspect to it. So we have medication there just in case. So if at any point you start feeling sick or anything like that, we can treat you right away. We have things to check your blood pressure, your heart rate, your oxygenation, just in case you need it at any point. But we're all there. We're all licensed. We all know how to give our shots and assess you afterwards. So if anyone has any questions, they can always ask us.
Abby, what about children? How come the vaccine is not available to children younger than 16 at this time?
So those initial case studies, when we were testing for those vaccines, they were done in a group of people that were over the age of 18 and over the age of 16 for Pfizer. Unfortunately, there isn't one for kids right now, but there are ongoing case studies to hopefully bring a vaccine that's suitable for everyone under the age of 15. We're not there yet, but that's why we're recommending parents, grandparents, uncles, and everyone that is around younger kids to get vaccinated. That way we're a protective barrier for them, so we don't pass anything on to them.
What about, I know Lorena mentioned, so even if we get the vaccine and we have both of them and we have, we wait the 2 weeks and we have full immunity, do we still have to wear our masks and keep our social distance?
That's a good question. So yes, each vaccine, like it was mentioned, provide a big number of protection. It's 94-95% effective, but because it's still, neither one is still that 100% effective yet, we still have to continue to wear our masks, continue to keep our 6 feet, continue to wash our hands, our new normal, just to continue to protect ourselves. It doesn't protect us from COVID, it protects us from our symptoms. So we want to be really careful. We're washing our hands at all times and continue to teach that to all of our family members.
What about, I know as like the weather gets nicer here and people are looking forward to summer and vacations and travel, do you have any kind of guidelines or any rules kind of around that that we should be paying attention to?
So make sure you're protected. Also do your research before you travel. There are a lot of different guidelines that are placed by like the airline. CDC puts guidelines on the different countries. They're rated on hot zones, orange zones. So depending on the infection rate, most times you still have to get tested before you fly or when you come back. And then there is that quarantine timeline, even with vaccination. So it's just making your research happen before you travel and then coming by back and following the CDC guidelines.
And I think another important part to follow there is that, you know, we don't know how accessible the vaccine is in other countries, right? And so we want to pay attention to their positivity rates, and then also just so that we're, even though we're protected, if we're going there and we're vaccinated, we want to know a little bit more about specifically the area that we're traveling to, just so that we have all the facts.
Exactly, right. Especially being careful with our new variants that are going on. I don't know if everyone has heard with the variants. There's the South African variant, the Brazilian one in the UK. So there are new mutations of this virus that, unfortunately, like any other virus, happens with time, but there are more prominent in certain areas of the world right now. So we want to make sure we're careful and do our research before traveling, or making sure that if there is a more extensive or stricter set of guidelines there, we respect those as well.
Abby, should people still get COVID tested if they are having symptoms? Is that something that we should still be doing?
So yes. So if someone is starting to display any symptoms or any known exposure to someone who's had COVID, we still want to be tested. It's based on employer about quarantining if someone does not have symptoms, but if they do, we should still be testing ourselves because it's still not 100% effective. There is that small risk that we can still catch COVID. So we want to make sure that we take that first step in being sure and protect ourselves and our family.
And Lorena, thank you for putting this up. What are some of the links and the websites that have the most kind of up-to-date, useful information? I know you've shared a lot of information. Where can people go to find out, kind of look through more of the details?
Yeah, so you can visit the Centers of Disease Prevention website. That is the most up-to-date information. They're always updating everything, especially now with the Johnson & Johnson vaccine being on pause, and they're constantly updating there. Just making sure you check there. That's the most credible information you'll find. And then every county has their own health department, so they'll get their information from the CDC and the Illinois Department of Public Health, and then they'll also create their own messages on their website. That is also accurate because it's all coming from the CDC. So if that makes it easier for you, or if you want to go straight up to the top and view the CDC, those are all websites. So make sure you're looking at your health department. So the Cook County Department of Public Health, DuPage Health Department website, and the CDC, and The FDA also has a little bit more information about the emergency use of the vaccines if you're interested in learning more about that. But I can link some of those on the chat.
So Lorena, what would you say about, you know, sometimes there's information on social media that is not based on facts, right? And so it creates more worry or some panic. And so how can we know if like what we're reading is factual?
So you want to keep an eye out for clinics, you know, your clinic website, your healthcare provider websites, hospital websites, universities that have like studies, and you want to stray away from people who are kind of just sharing opinion-based myths. You want to make sure that you're looking at credible sources like physicians or, again, like officials from the CDC.
Thank you. Thank you. And Lorena, you also talked about different ways that people can access and that now, as we moved further through the phases, right, that we are opening up and having more access. And so can you tell us again a little bit about how to sign up if we are not like technologically savvy, or we have a senior, or just kind of have maybe like English as a second language? Just want to make sure that people know how to access appointments as much as possible.
Yeah, so we have in Cook County, we have the vaccine.cookcountyillinois.gov. This one, you would have to navigate a website. So if you have any younger, the younger generation, people who are tech savvy, then they can go ahead and sign themselves up. If you speak Spanish and you want to call through the phone instead, then you can call the vaccine sign-up hotline. They have, they're available in English and Spanish, Monday through Friday and Saturday. And then in DuPage County, they have the same thing, except it's dupagehealth.org. And again, you can sign up for the vaccine or call for assistance. And then there are also federally qualified health centers. So if you're a patient in one of these federally qualified health centers that are offering the vaccine, you can go during your appointment, call during regular hours and see how you can schedule the vaccine. You can also schedule an appointment at the Walgreens, Joe Osco, Mariano, CVS using their website. You would obviously have to be checking out to see if they have vaccines available because it changes every week. And then there will be community pop-ups. So these are more accessible to those who are non-English speaking and also may not have like technology available to access a vaccine and sign up by themselves. There will be community health workers in different organizations like I am. And so I'm an example of those people who are out there helping others register for the vaccine without having to access the internet or a phone or anything like that. And then again, if you live in Chicago and do not work in any of the west suburb places where you can get a vaccine, then you can also get a vaccine in Chicago. They have a lot of resources over there as well.
Wonderful. I know we have two participants. I don't know if you have any questions that maybe we've missed or anything you want to ask before we end our time together.
I would like to ask, what should we be doing to prep for the vaccine? I know with like the flu shot, you're supposed to be getting as much rest as possible, but I would think that would be the same thing for the COVID. I also heard not to be taking any antihistamines or Tylenol before, or restrained from liquor a few days before. Is any of that true, or can you give us a little insight in that?
Yeah, so yes, you want your body to be at an optimal state when receiving that vaccine. So, mm-hmm. Unless told by your physician to prep in any sort, we want to stay away from medications that'll kind of change your immune system right before. So no allergy medicine unless you have a need for it, and nor Tylenol or ibuprofen before. If anything, if like we mentioned, if you start having more of those cold-like symptoms where you're having a headache or a fever or any body aches, that's when we would recommend taking anything for pain relief or fever relief, like your Tylenol or ibuprofen, whichever one you normally go to, or if you want to just have a double check with your doctor.
And this is after the vaccine?
Afterwards.
Right.
Only if you need it, not routinely. So just in case you are having any of those symptoms, you want to make sure you take something for the symptom, but not routinely afterwards, every 6 or 8 hours, only if you need it. And then, like you mentioned, rest as much as you can. Don't overexert yourself. Your body is busy doing its job, preparing, you know, making that immunity, and then drink a lot of water. Like I mentioned, there are no restrictions with medication, foods, or drinks. We just say counteract that with more water, because water helps kind of flush everything through, helps circulate everything. And then for soreness, I tend to tell my patients, you are going to be a little sore. It's going to be like a flu shot where this little area is sore. 20 minutes ice pack over your shirt can help, and then you can alternate with something warm. Ice helps with pain and swelling. Warmth helps relax that muscle.
Okay.
Thank you, Norma.
Thank you.
Yes, hello. Thank you for this presentation. I have a question about administering the vaccine. I know that we're going to administer Moderna, right? So I have been trained. I've been giving Pfizer. So what's the main difference in administering the actual vaccine between Moderna and Pfizer?
So the biggest thing is just the time for when we're teaching our patients when to come back. The Pfizer is the 21 days, the 3 weeks. The Moderna is the 4 weeks. And it's basically each vial has its own set of dose numbers from the Pfizer Moderna. You get about 10 doses, sometimes 11 doses. I'm not sure with the Pfizer, you might get a little less. And it's the time they can be refrigerated and stored. That's basically the only difference between the two.
Okay.
Did that answer your question? Dima, are you still there?
We lost her.
Oh no.
any final kind of points that we want to make? Anything, Abby, that comes up regularly at the clinic that maybe I didn't ask or didn't come up from our community questions?
So another question that I normally have is for our pregnant moms who are thinking about getting that vaccine. Normally we have them, yes, get it cleared with your doctor, but if everyone is fine, we actually recommend it, especially for our breastfeeding moms, because your body's starting to do those antibodies through the breast milk. It's actually being passed on to baby. So the baby also has some immunity to it as well. And just rest. There should not be any nerves. It should be excitement with getting the shot, as long as we all remember to keep our masks, keep the distance, keep the hand washing. And then if there's any type of questions throughout the process, to make sure that they ask their vaccinator.
I'm so sorry, Abby. I missed all the answer because of the disconnection issue. I'm so sorry.
No worries, Sima. So to your questions on the difference, both of them are stored differently and they're handled differently. It's still an intramuscular shot, so it's gonna go right here in your arm. The only difference is when we teach our patients when to come back, Pfizer is the 21 days or the 3 weeks, and the Moderna, it's the 28 days or the 4 weeks.
I see, okay. Well, other than that, administering the vaccine, same thing is the same, right?
It's
like
the same.
Like the shot itself, it's the same thing.
Everything is the same. It's still about 0.5. I'm assuming that the time it stays out is different, but it's still going in your deltoid muscle. still the same.
Okay, thank you so much. I really appreciate it. Thank you.
You're welcome.
I think we're just about to wrap up our English session of our Q&A. We are going to host a Spanish language one at 7 o'clock, and that will be in the same Zoom information. And we want to make this available as in many languages as possible, especially knowing that our community is so diverse and it's so important to get this information out. So by tomorrow, we will have, as I mentioned, the same presentation in English, Spanish, Arabic, and Urdu. And so we will have a posting of that so that we can, again, get as many questions answered leading into our pop-up community event that's going to be on Saturday in Willowbrook. So if there's not any other questions, I think then we will wrap up our English session.
Thanks for joining
us. Thank you
so much. Thank you.
Thank you. It was very informative.
Thank you for joining us.
You're welcome. I'm glad you had it. Oh, it set our minds at ease on a lot of things.
Good, good. And then we'll see you on Saturday.
All right, then. See you then. Till then, take care.
You stay too. Safe. Thank you. Well, buenas tardes. Bienvenidos a la conversación sobre la vacuna y la comunidad. Gracias por estar con nosotros. Vamos a empezar. Yo me llamo Ana Padrón Sicora y soy una trabajadora social con la agencia de Pillars Community Health. Yo he trabajado en la comunidad más con el tema de salud mental, pero en estos días he estado trabajando con mis compañeras para tener las pláticas sobre la importancia de la información sobre la vacuna. So, hoy vamos a tener una presentación de Lorena, y entonces tenemos a Abby, que es una enfermera en la clínica de nosotros en Pillars Community Health, y ella va a poder contestar muchas de las preguntas que ustedes tienen en la comunidad sobre la vacuna y cómo podemos prepararnos lo más posible para estar lista para recibir la vacuna. So, con eso voy a dejar que Lorena se presente y empiece su presentación.
Buenas tardes, mi nombre es Lorena. Yo soy la especialista de educación de salud, específicamente COVID. Lo que he estado haciendo es enseñando a la comunidad cómo prevenir COVID-19, y también estoy compartiendo información sobre la vacuna para que todos puedan tomar las decisiones educadas sobre si se quieren poner la vacuna o no. Entonces voy a presentar después de que Abby se introduzca.
Hi, buenas tardes. Yo me llamo Abby. Soy una enfermera registrada aquí en la clínica de Pillars. Soy también una coordinadora de vacunas. Trabajo en nuestra clínica de vacunas de COVID. Tengo experiencia siendo enfermera por 5 años. Parte de mi experiencia es en cuidados intensivos, control de infección, salud de empleados y ahora salud pública. Pero voy a ser la que va a contestar preguntas. Gracias, Lorena.
Gracias, Abby. So, voy a empezar mi presentación. Y esta información que voy a compartir es directamente del CDC y también del Departamento de Salud de Cook County. Entonces, comenzaremos con la información sobre la vacuna del COVID-19. Lo que cubriremos hoy será seguridad, cómo funcionan las vacunas, tipos de vacunas, beneficios de ponerse la vacuna, el costo y distribución, y seguiremos con las preguntas. Entonces, quería comenzar con esto que dijeron en los centros de disease control y prevención, que las vacunas cumplieron con los rigurosos estándares de la FDA en cuanto a seguridad, eficacia y calidad de fabricación necesarias para respaldar la autorización de uso de emergencia. Entonces, las vacunas del COVID-19 son seguras y efectivas. No se omitieron pasos durante el proceso del ensayo clínico para las vacunas COVID-19. El proceso de la vacuna fue más rápido de lo normal porque algunos pasos se realizaron al mismo tiempo en lugar de uno después de otro. Entonces queremos comenzar con asegurándolo que esta vacuna, las tres vacunas, son eficaces, pero también han sido seguras y estudiadas muy bien, aunque muy rápidamente. ¿Cómo funcionan las vacunas? Cuando nos enfermamos, nuestro cuerpo usa glóbulos rojos y blancos para combatir las infecciones. El sistema inmunológico aprende a combatir el virus. Las vacunas ayudan a desarrollar inmunidad al virus sin que la persona se infecte con el virus COVID-19. Entonces, como vemos que nos enfermamos, tenemos células de memorias que recuerdan cómo combatimos ese virus. Igualmente con la vacuna pasa lo mismo, pero nunca nos enfermamos con el virus COVID-19. Hay dos tipos de vacunas, la vacuna de ARNm y la vacuna vectorial. Las vacunas de ARNm dan instrucciones para que nuestras células produzcan una pieza inofensiva que se llama proteína de pico. Una vez que las instrucciones están dentro de las células inmunitarias, las células las usan para fabricar la pieza de proteína. Nuestro sistema inmunológico reconoce que la proteína no pertenece ahí y desarrolla una respuesta inmunológica produciendo anticuerpos. Entonces, cuando nos expongamos al virus del COVID-19 en el futuro, estos anticuerpos ya estarán allí para ayudarnos a combatir el virus, sin tener que enfermarnos de COVID-19. Tenemos dos vacunas que son de este tipo. Es la marca Pfizer, que son dos inyecciones, al menos 21 días aparte. No contiene huevos, conservantes ni látex y es 95% eficaz en la prevención de COVID-19. Moderna es otra marca, pero el mismo tipo de vacuna. Es dos inyecciones, al menos 28 días aparte. Tampoco contiene huevos, conservantes ni látex y es 94.5 eficaz en la prevención de COVID-19. Tenemos una vacuna vectorial que hemos visto. Las vacunas vectoriales funcionan con un vector que no es el virus que causa COVID-19, sino un diferente virus. Este virus, este vector entrará en una célula de nuestro cuerpo para producir una parte inofensiva del virus que causa COVID-19. Nuestro sistema inmunológico reconoce que no pertenece allí y como las vacunas de ARNm, nuestro sistema reconoce que no pertenece allí, por eso produce anticuerpos y activa nuestras células inmunitarias para combatir lo que cree que es infección. Hemos visto la Johnson & Johnson, que es una vacuna que requiere una inyección nada más, no contiene huevos, conservantes ni látex y es 66% eficaz en la prevención de COVID-19. Actualización sobre la vacuna Johnson & Johnson del 4-13, que fue abril 13, fue la semana pasada. El uso de esta vacuna está en pausa por ahora. Esto se debe a que los sistemas de seguridad que garantizan que las vacunas sean seguras recibieron unos pocos informes de un tipo raro y grave de coágulo sanguíneo que ocurre en personas que recibieron esta vacuna. Quería mencionar que estos casos fueron 6 casos nada más de casi 7 millones de vacunas que han sido administradas. Entonces, están estudiando y ahorita está en pausa por precaución, pero en cuanto nos informemos más de lo que encuentren los estudios, podemos ver que la vacuna Johnson & Johnson regrese. Y aquí es una comparización. Aquí tenemos Pfizer, Moderna, Johnson & Johnson, que como les dije, son las marcas de vacunas. El tipo es ARNm en Pfizer y Moderna y vector viral en Johnson & Johnson. Pfizer y Moderna son dos dosis, Johnson & Johnson es una dosis. Y aquí vemos también la máxima efectividad. ¿Qué significa esto? Esto significa que en cuánto tiempo después de vacunarse estoy inmuno al COVID-19. Entonces, para la Pfizer sería 7 días después de la segunda dosis. En Moderna sería 14 días después de la segunda dosis. Y Johnson & Johnson sería 28 días después de la única dosis. Y es cuando tenía la máxima eficaz que vimos en el otro slide que vemos aquí, que sería 95%, 94.5% en Moderna y 66% con Johnson & Johnson. La eficacia de las vacunas tiene variedad, pero todas son 100% eficaz contra la muerte y tiene gran eficaz contra infecciones graves que lo lleven al hospital. ¿Qué puede esperar después de vacunarse? Algunas personas no tienen efectos secundarios. Muchos informan dolor o hinchazón en el lugar de la inyección, dolor de cabeza, dolores musculares, escalofríos o fiebre. Alguna gente nada más padece de un síntoma. Algunos tienen todos los síntomas, pero todos son normal y desaparecen en 3 días, en 1 a 3 días. ¿Cuáles son los beneficios de vacunarse? Ayuda a evitar que contraiga COVID-19, evita que se enferme gravemente, incluso si contrae el COVID-19, protege a las personas que te rodean, es una manera segura de construir protección, su sistema inmunológico combatirá el virus si está expuesto y ayude a detener la pandemia. El costo de la vacuna es que no hay costo, la vacuna es gratis. No es necesario estar asegurado para recibir una vacuna, pero si tiene seguro, usamos el seguro, la información de su seguro para el reembolso de la administración. No le cobrarán nada. Todos los residentes del condado de Cook, igual que el condado de DuPage y que todo Illinois, son elegibles para vacunarse, incluidos los residentes indocumentados. Distribución, aquí vemos que teníamos dosis limitadas disponibles, entonces por eso teníamos la fase 1, la fase 1A, 1B, 1B plus, y es porque no teníamos muchas vacunas, pero ahora nos estamos moviendo a la fase 2, donde tenemos una gran cantidad de dosis disponibles y vamos a ver que mucha gente se va a poder vacunar más rápido. Y aquí tenemos las fases que hemos visto. Cada condado y cada estado tiene diferentes fases y se está moviendo por las fases a diferentes, en diferentes tiempos. Pero ahorita todos los individuos 16 años y mayores podrán vacunarse. En Cook County se puede registrar para la vacuna usando el programa de vacunación comunitaria en vaccine.cookcountyill.gov. También por teléfono pueden llamar entre las horas 7 y 10 de la tarde, lunes a viernes, sábado de las 8 de la mañana a las 10 de la tarde. Y allí tienen opción de hablar en español también. Y si necesita alguien que vaya a la casa a ponerle la vacuna, porque no puede salir, puede llamar al 833-308-1988. En DuPage County se puede registrar en dupagehealth.org o por teléfono 630-682-7400. Otros sitios de vacunación son centros de salud como Pillars Community Health, donde tenemos una clínica de vacunación. Hay farmacias como Walgreens, Joe Osco, Mariano, CVS, y usted puede entrar a la página de web de estas farmacias para registrarse. y va a haber sitios de comunidad que van a tener la vacuna. Entonces, este evento que tendremos el sábado va a ser un sitio donde Pillars Community Health va a estar allí dando las vacunas. Y si vives en Chicago y no trabajas en unos suburbios que ofrecen estas vacunas, puedes encontrar una vacuna en chicago.gov, Vaccine Finder. Y recuerden que usen su mascarilla, controlen su distancia, mantengan al menos 6 pies de distancia, lávese las manos frecuentemente por al menos 20 segundos y si no puede, use hand sanitizer de 60% de alcohol, hágase la prueba si tiene síntomas de COVID-19, responda a la llamada de rastreaderos de contacto si ha sido expuesto a alguien que tiene COVID-19 y cuando sea elegible o cuando se le ofrezca y pueda, vacúnese. Y aquí, este es un sitio comunitario que ofrece la vacuna para los que viven o trabajan en Summit, McCook, Hodgkins, Justice, Bridgeview, Chicago Ridge. Pueden hablar para hacer su cita entre lunes a viernes 7 a 10 de la tarde o sábado de las 8 de la mañana a las 10 de la tarde. Hablan inglés y español y este es un ejemplo de un sitio comunitario que se llama Pop-Up y veremos más de esos en el futuro. Y es todo. Gracias.
Muchísimas gracias, Lorena. Muy bien, mucha información, muy importante, ¿verdad? Y entonces, lo que queremos hacer es seguir con la plática sobre las preguntas que han salido de la comunidad. Y Lorena hizo un trabajo muy bueno en cubrir muchas preguntas que lo han salido, que los da ansiedad o que los preocupa. Y entonces queremos tomar esta oportunidad que estamos con Adi para que ella los explique, como ella es enfermera y está en la clínica todos los días, cuáles son las preguntas que las personas le preguntan a usted todos los días y qué podemos esperar, ¿verdad? Si uno tiene cita y está preparando para venir a tomar la vacuna, ¿qué los puedes explicar para como que estar seguro en cómo va a estar el proceso?
Okay, de lo que se puede esperar es después de que ya haya hecho una cita por medio de teléfono o por internet, uno llega a la cita, le toman su temperatura, le dan un cuestionario que usted ya después llena, les dan una tarjeta de identificación o algo que tenga una foto y su nombre completo. Si tiene aseguranza, la puede presentar, si no, no se preocupen. Guardamos esa información para hacer un expediente en la clínica, pero esa información nunca sale a otro lugar. No importa si uno es el estatus inmigratorio, la vacuna, como mencionó Lorena, es gratuita para todos. Después de llenar el formulario, ya uno va explicando si tiene algún síntoma de flu, alguna condición médica, alguna alergia, la reacción de su alergia, algún tipo de medicamento que estén tomando actualmente. Llenan su consentimiento de obtener la vacuna, se pasan a una estación con una de las enfermeras, repasan la información juntos, contestan alguna pregunta que tengan de inmediato antes de tener la vacuna para sentirse seguros y cómodos. Si necesitan algún traductor, les ayudan a traducir la información en español. Y se les va explicando el tipo de vacuna que van a recibir, si es Pfizer, si es Moderna. Si es Moderna, se les explica que la vacuna tiene un porcentaje de 95% que es efectiva, que viene siendo la efectividad depende de obtener las dos vacunas o regresar en un mes. También se les explica cómo no es 100% todavía, que de todos modos, aún teniendo la vacuna, que es necesario seguir protegiéndose con el uso del cubrebocas, lavándose las manos y guardando distancia. Y después se les entrega un paquete de la información de la vacuna que pueden llevarse en casa. se les da también un papel con una aplicación que pueden bajar que les va siguiendo mientras ya han pasado tiempo, les manda mensaje de texto, les crea un record electrónico de su vacuna, se les recuerda de su siguiente cita y ya después de que hayan tenido la vacuna esperan 15 minutos como medio de precaución en caso de que haya una reacción adversa inmediata para poder tratarlos, y si alguien tiene una alergia más severa se esperan 30 minutos. Si todos también se sienten bien, después de ahí se pueden retirar. So, algunas de las preguntas que usualmente me preguntan es ¿qué tipo de efectos secundarios voy a tener? Les explicamos que los síntomas varían persona en persona. Como la vacuna no tiene el virus vivo de COVID, no se pueden enfermar de COVID, sino es el propio cuerpo adaptándose a la vacuna. So, siempre explico que los síntomas son muy parecidos a un resfriado, parecen como dolor de cabeza, fiebre, escalofríos, dolores musculares, dolor del brazo, cansancio. Todos esos síntomas es normal. Es el mismo cuerpo trabajando para protegernos. Si, no es necesariamente que uno va a tener todos esos síntomas, sino es que es probable poder tener uno, algunos o ninguno, que también es normal. Si los tienen, les explicamos que de manera de tratarlos es tomando mucha agua, descansando, no ejercitarse uno. Pueden tomar el Tylenol o el ibuprofen para dolor o fiebre. Y no asustarse, porque eso es algo normal. Un poquito de hielo, algo calientito para relajar el brazo y esperar, porque esos síntomas van a ser leves, no más de 2 a 3 días, no más de la semana, ya cuando es algo más severo o algo fuera de lo normal, es cuando los recomendamos que vayan con su doctor.
Gracias, Abby. Y y platícanos si las personas a veces vienen y como que están de nervios o están preocupados y entonces como que le da miedo, ¿no? ¿Cómo usted responde o qué consejo les puede dar?
Siempre queremos de que estén cómodos de encontrar la razón por la cual tienen muchos nervios, porque tienen miedo. A veces hay mucha información de las noticias que nos preocupan, o encontramos información por medios no tan recomendables. Se puede escuchar de Facebook, de los medios sociales, de los familiares. Queremos que todos tengan información confiable, que si tienen alguna pregunta antes de vacunarse, que lo pregunten, que si les preocupan el lenguaje, que se sientan a gusto sabiendo de que hay alguien ahí traduciéndolo para que ellos lo entiendan bien. La información se explica muy sencillamente para que todos los entiendan, y que sabemos que es algo de nervios cuando se trata de algo nuevo, pero como explicó Lorena, la información de las vacunas tomó tiempo en estudiarse, es algo que pasó un proceso muy riguroso, o es confiable tenerlos, y explicar que es algo bueno, es algo para nuestra protección, algo que nos beneficia.
Abby, a veces algunos padres me han preguntado que por qué la vacuna está disponible como para los adultos y no para los niños. ¿Los puedes explicar un poco?
So, cuando se hicieron los estudios de las vacunas, cada vacuna se hizo su grupo de personas que estudiaron con la vacuna, y durante cada caso de las vacunas se estudió de adultos de 18 para arriba, o para el Pfizer de 16 para arriba. So, no, todavía no hay mucha información de los niños. Ahorita se están estudiando más a detalle actualmente sobre las vacunas de los niños, ya sí los pueden pasar así seguramente. So, por ahorita, aunque no está disponible para los niños, estamos recomendando que todos los papás, los familiares adultos, los abuelos, los tíos, los primos que ya tienen suficiente edad y califican, que la obtengan para así proteger a los niños que todavía no la pueden tener.
Y Abby, si ya me he vacunado y ya he esperado las 2 semanas, ¿todavía tengo que seguir usando el
cubrebocas?
Y tener la distancia y lavarme las manos, y todo eso sigue siendo importante.
Sí, las vacunas tienen mucho porcentaje que son eficaz. Las dos tienen un porcentaje grande que nos protegen sobre el COVID, sobre infecciones más severas secundarias de COVID, pero las tres no son 100% efectivas contra el COVID. So, aunque tengan un porcentaje grande, no es 100% todavía, y por eso es que recomendamos que nosotros tomemos precaución de todos modos, usando el cubrebocas, lavándonos las manos seguidos, guardando distancia, así nos protegemos a nosotros y nuestra familia.
Y que me han preguntado también que si una mujer está embarazada, si es buena idea a recibir la vacuna.
Siempre nos aseguramos que la persona hable con su doctor primero, porque sus doctores tienen su historial médico, lo entienden mejor que nosotros. So, aunque si el doctor dice que sí, entonces sí, hasta lo recomendamos para las mamás que están amamantando, porque al uno obtener la vacuna y empezar a crear su inmunidad contra el virus, lo pueden pasar también por la leche con los bebés. So, siempre preguntar a su doctor y ya después tomar esa decisión.
Es muy buena información. ¿Y qué pasa si no tengo identificación de aquí de los Estados Unidos, o si no tengo a lo mejor un número social? ¿Eso es algo que puede introducir en poder recibir la vacuna?
No, el tener un número social no es algo requerido. De hecho, no preguntamos su estatus inmigratorio. Lo que pedimos es que muestren algo de identificación con una foto y su nombre completo. Puede ser un ID, su licencia, una mica, un pasaporte, algo que muestre que es la persona, su fecha de nacimiento y su nombre. Algo que puede identificar a uno.
Y usted platicó que necesitamos las dos vacunas, pero me imagino que una vacuna es mejor que ninguna, ¿verdad? Pero que sí necesitamos las dos para poder estar completo. ¿Me puede hablar un poco más de esa situación?
So, sí, como mencionó Lorena en su presentación, cuando difirió entre las tres, depende de la cantidad de dosis con la vacuna que uno recibe. So, la Pfizer y la Moderna, el fabricante mostró que para que sean eficaz completamente necesitamos esas dos dosis. La única diferencia entre Pfizer y Moderna es lo frecuente que regresamos. O la Pfizer es en 3 semanas, Moderna es en 4 semanas, y la Johnson & Johnson con una y ya. Pero teniendo la primera vacuna, toma unas semanas para que el cuerpo se vaya adaptando y vaya creando esos anticuerpos para protegernos. Por eso, en la tercera categoría, bajo máxima efectividad, siempre explicamos, teniendo las dos dosis, ya un tiempo después es cuando uno está considerado completamente vacunado, o cuando la vacuna toma una efectividad mayor. So, la Pfizer le toma una semana después de su segunda dosis, la Moderna son 2 semanas después de su segunda dosis, y ya la Johnson y Johnson 2 semanas a 4 semanas después de su primera dosis. So, una vacuna sí es mejor que ninguna, porque ya va uno creando los anticuerpos de protección, pero es mejor tener lo que es recomendable, las dos vacunas, porque así tenemos un número mayor de protegernos y nos protege por más tiempo.
Y me imagino que, Abby, ahora que el tiempo se está poniendo mejor y que estamos pensando en el verano, y especialmente después de un año que ha sido bastante difícil, ¿verdad? Estamos pensando en cómo podemos viajar o cómo podemos ir a visitar a familiares que a lo mejor no hemos visto por todo el año. ¿Qué consejos nos das sobre viajar y cómo protegernos?
So, recomendaría hacer nuestra nuestra propia búsqueda de información. Queremos estar muy educados antes de planear un viaje, a vacunarnos por lo menos con una dosis, si es posible, y recordar de regresar y tomarnos la segunda dosis. Pero siempre fijarnos en las restricciones que hay, o sea, de la aerolínea, del país donde viajamos, qué son las restricciones que tienen ellos, si es necesario hacernos el examen de COVID antes de irnos y después cuando regresar, buscar información en la página de la CDC, porque a veces ciertos países tienen número de contagio un poquito mayor. Queremos hacer nuestra búsqueda, fijarnos si los países sí están aceptando que entremos, porque ahorita hay mucha información sobre los variantes del virus que queremos protegernos, si sea exponiéndonos a salir o entrar. So, por eso queremos, de todos modos, aunque nos pongamos la vacuna, de todos modos tener esa precaución al viajar usando nuestro cubrebocas, buscando información y regresar para la segunda dosis.
Y que también no sabemos a veces en las otras partes del mundo a qué tal tienen la vacuna, so queremos saber toda esa información antes de ir a pasar tiempo allá. Y también algunos de las aerolíneas también tenemos que tomar un examen de COVID cuando regresemos para estar segura que no estamos trayendo más infección a nuestra comunidad, ¿verdad?
Correcto. A veces hay un tiempo de cuarentena que cuando al regresar tenemos que tomar para aislarnos y después tomarnos ese examen que nos muestra que somos negativos para ya así regresar a nuestro diario vivir al trabajo, a la escuela. So, obedecer esos reglamentos.
Yeah. Lorena, ¿los puedes platicar un poco de los dices muy buena información? Y entonces si seguimos querer más información, más detalles, a veces uno, como dice Abby, que queremos buscar en nuestro tiempo. ¿Cuáles son los websites o los links que tienen la información más segura?
Sí, so comenzando con el cdc.gov, allí es donde hay más información y de allí agarran la información todos nuestros departamentos de salud. Entonces puede ir directamente allí o también puede ir a los sitios de web de su departamento de salud, como Cook County. El condado de Cook tiene su propio departamento de salud y su propio sitio de web donde ellos tienen mensajes e información sobre COVID-19 y la vacuna. También DuPage County tiene su propio website, pero toda la información que tienen ahí es del CDC. Entonces, si quieren la información directamente de allí, pueden ir allí. Traten de no escuchar o leer cosas que son opiniadas de la gente. Nada más son pláticas de la gente y la gente no sabe en verdad la realidad. Puede hacerle preguntas a su doctor, su enfermera, en su clínica cuando vaya. O también ver en los estudios que están haciendo, puede ver páginas de web y redes sociales que son de un hospital o de una universidad o, como dije, del CDC.
Y Lorena, si alguien tiene dificultad con el internet o cómo encontrar para una cita, ¿qué consejos le puedes dar, especialmente ahora que las citas están como más disponibles, no?
Sí, hay más citas más disponibles porque hay más vacunas. Entonces eso es bueno, pero también significa que hay mucha gente que está haciendo sus citas y esos que no tienen acceso al internet o a lo mejor no saben usar la computadora, entonces se van a encontrar preguntando cómo hago la cita. Entonces hay opciones en el centro de salud. Si usted va a un centro de salud, puede preguntar si tienen la vacuna disponible allí y hacer su cita allí mismo. También hay farmacias Aquí es donde sería por el internet, pero va a haber sitios de comunidad más comunes que vamos a ver. Entonces, hay mucha gente como yo que estamos ayudando a la gente a registrarse para la vacuna sin tener que ustedes ir al internet o hacer una llamada. Pero si se quieren inscribir, pueden hacerlo por teléfono también. Y tienen inglés y español. Están abiertos de las 7 de la mañana a las 10 de la tarde y de lunes a viernes, y hasta el sábado también están abiertos de las 8 de la mañana a las 10 de la tarde. Y ahí nada más le mandan un mensaje con su confirmación y están listos con su cita. Esto lo tiene Cook County y también el condado de DuPage.
Abby, so la pregunta más común que me han preguntado es que ¿cuál vacuna es la mejor?
Las tres son muy buenas. Yo solamente digo que la que tienen acceso, primeramente la que esté enfrente de ellos o de uno. Las tres ayudan a protegernos. Nos ayudan a prevenir a que nos enfermemos gravemente, que nos lleven al hospital con esos síntomas muy graves o severos. Previenen que nosotros estemos en cuidados intensivos, que nos intuban o que lleguemos hasta la muerte. Son las tres, cual sea en frente de nosotros, cuando siempre sea que estemos mayor de 16 con la Pfizer o mayor de 18 con la Moderna. Son las tres, son muy eficaces. Nos beneficiamos de cualquiera que esté enfrente de nosotros.
Y yo creo que eso es lo más importante, ¿verdad? Que cada uno tiene que tener la confianza que la ciencia y la comunidad está trabajando bien duro para que podemos seguir sobreviviendo esta pandemia, ¿verdad? Y por eso queremos seguir estos tipos de pláticas. Esta información es de hoy, que es abril 19 de 2021, pero la información sigue cambiando. Esto es lo que sabemos hasta hoy en día y queremos compartir lo más que podemos para que, como las citas están más disponibles, que las personas se sientan con confianza y que tengan la información que necesitan para hacer esas decisiones para no nomás usted, pero para su familia, ¿verdad? Y para su comunidad. Y entonces vamos a seguir ofreciendo todo el apoyo y toda la ayuda que nosotros podemos, como la agencia de Pillars Community Health y todos los otros agencias que están en la comunidad para seguir adelante, ¿verdad? Para seguir, para tener más esperanza que el virus de corona sea menos y menos afectando nuestras vidas, ¿verdad? Y que no tenemos que seguir teniendo esos limitados que hemos pasado por este último año.
Tenemos que ver la vacuna como el primer paso de regresar a la normalidad. Mientras todos hacemos nuestra propia parte y todos nos estamos protegiendo, menos y menos casos vamos a ver. Y pronto, poco a poco, vamos a volver a la normalidad y gozar de como estábamos antes. Por eso tenemos que tomar acción, buscar información y protegernos a nosotros y a la familia.
Y si están de dudas, que pregunten, que no hay ninguna pregunta que no es buena. Y y con confianza vamos a llegar a un lugar más saludable, ¿no? Uh-huh. ¿Hay algunos últimos temas o preguntas antes que terminemos esta plática? ¿Lorena o Abby?
Yo solamente iba a mencionar que como dijiste, que si hay alguna duda, alguna inquietud, alguna preocupación antes de sobre la vacuna, que como dijeron, pregunten a su doctor, pregunten a la persona que los va a vacunar antes para que estén cómodos con la decisión. ver que los sitios de vacunación tienen personas que son bilingües, o si es una inquietud sobre el lenguaje, saber que hay personas que puedan traducir, hay personas que hablan en español, que pueden explicar la información de manera sencilla y entendible, y que cada estación es un centro de confianza. O sea, uno puede poder hacer esas preguntas y sentirse a gusto de su decisión.
Y que nosotros sabemos que la vacuna es un pedazo, ¿verdad?, de nuestra salud. So, a veces los mismos lugares de la salud, departamento de salud o la agencia como nosotros, tenemos muchos servicios, ¿verdad? Y a lo mejor puede enterarse de nosotros por la vacuna, pero que se enteren de otros servicios que a lo mejor podemos apoyar a su familias, so sea con a lo mejor con médicos, servicios dental o de otros apoyos que a lo mejor le convienen para su familia. So, estamos aquí para ayudarles. So, cuando vengan a recibir la vacuna, sin pena, los preguntan por todos los servicios que ofrecemos. Well, muy buenas noches y gracias por estar con nosotros y los vemos pronto. Buena suerte.